lesson here is you are not qualified to ask Allah's protection unless you are in Allah's obedience. If one is disobedient to Allah, they have no right to be asking Allah's protection. They need to come in Allah's obedience first. The second thing about qul is it's a declaration. You have to declare that you're seeking refuge. You know, your ego gets in the way of saying, I need help. I need protection. The first thing your ego says is, I can take care of myself. I can handle this. But when Allah commands us to openly declare, you know, it's different from saying, Ista'idhu bi Rabbin Nas. Seek protection from the Master. You could do that secretly. But Allah says, Qul, declare it. Say it out loud. When you say out loud, I need protection, what have you done? You've slammed your ego and you've humbled yourself before Allah, saying, I can't protect myself, He can protect me. It's actually a killing of the ego. And this is part of the lesson here. Part of the lesson is humility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a crushing of one's own nafs. Now, فَإِن قُلْتْ لِمَا قِيلْ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. How come Allah says رَبُّ النَّاسِ مُضَافًا إِلَيْهِمْ خَاصَّةً. How come He extended Himself, His rububiyah, His lordship, His mastery towards people specifically? He could say, you know, رَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبِّهِمْ. You know, why nas specifically? And the way ulama comment on this, لِأَنَّ الْإِسْتِعَاذَةَ وَقَعَتْ مِنْ شَرِّ الْمُوَسْوِسِ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ فَكَأَنَّهُ قِيلْ. It is because the people are the one who need protection in this surah. The skies and the earth don't need protection from shaitan. Who needs protection from shaitan? Who needs protection from al-waswas al-khannas? It's the people. So Allah extended His mastery, His lordship over the people. It's relevant to them. فَكَأَنَّهُ قِيلْ. It is as though what's being said is, أَعُوذُ مِنْ شَرِّ الْمُوَسْوِسِ إِلَى النَّاسِ بِرَبِّهِمْ أَلَّذِي يَمْلِكُ عَلَيْهِمْ أُمُورَهُمْ. It is as though you're saying, I seek my refuge from the one, the evil of the one who whispers towards people, by seeking protection with my master, with their Lord, the one who has authority even over them and all of their affairs. Now, there is the word that I want to pay extra attention to this time that I didn't last time, but we're going to pay a little bit more time and attention to it, is the word Rabb. It's very important. In Surah Al-Ikhlas, you remember we spent extra time on the word Allah. We spend a little extra time on the word Allah and its origin and things like that. Now we have to spend a little extra time on the word Rabb, linguistically speaking. The word Rabb in Arabic, if you look at the linguistic origin, has several implications in it. But the first and primary of them is, you know, absolute owner, like even a slave owner or the owner of a house. For example, Rabbu Abdin, Rabb, the master of a slave. Oh, Rabbul Bayt. Rabbul Bayt meaning the owner of a house. But it's not just any kind of owner, because you know, another word for ownership is Malik. So you could also say Malikul Bayt, the owner of a house. So then the question is, how is the ownership of the word Rabb different from the ownership of Malik? That's the one thing I want to bring to your attention first. Actually, ownership is only one part of the many meanings of the word Rabb. While Malik exclusively means owner, Rabb includes the meaning of Malik, but includes other things too. So what are these other things? الرب هو المالك والسيد والمربي والمرشد والقيم والمنعم. Several things are included inside the word رب. Now let's look at all of them. I know I've discussed this before, but we need this review for this lesson, inshallah ta'ala. الرب هو المالك, I just said his owner. But then I said والسيد, who has the complete authority also. The one who's completely in charge. Is it possible you own something but you're not completely in charge of it? Like your car, right? You own it, but you have to get it inspected, you have to get it registered, you can't take it at any speed you want, you can't modify it any way you want. You have ownership, but it's limited ownership because it doesn't come with full authority. A Rabb is someone who has ownership and at the same time also has authority. He could do whatever he wants with it. He wants to burn it, he can burn it. He wants to tear it apart, he could tear it apart. Right? There's no one to ask any questions because he has complete authority. So al-Malik was Sayyid. Then wal-Murabbi. This is a very interesting and powerful word. You know, some people get confused about root origins of words because of a lack of knowledge of sarf. Surah Al-Isra. Allah says, وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي. رَبَّيَانِي. Right? He says, Master, رَبْ ارْحَمْهُمَا. Show mercy to both of them, meaning both of my parents. كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي. Now what word did you just hear? رَبْ. In Rabbayani. So some people start thinking Rabbayani here, the root letters, the origin is also Rabb. Because it sounds like Rabb, Rabbayani. But this is actually, the fi'l here isn't, what do you call it, Muda'af. It's not Ra, Ba, Ba. It's actually Ra, Ba, and Wow. Rabba, Yurabbi, Tarbiya. Tarbiya. The last letter in the root is not Ba, it's Wow. Now, what difference does it make? When you say Rabba, Rabb with Ra, Ba, Ba, if that's the root origin, those are the meanings we're discussing. But if you say Rabba, so Rabba and Wow, then the meaning is different. That meaning Tarbiyah, you know, you ever heard Tarbiyah? Tarbiyah is to ensure the growth and maturity of something until it reaches the stage that you want it to reach. Tarbiyah of a plant would be you taking care of that plant, you're watering it, it's getting enough sun until it matures into a tree and starts bearing fruit. Tarbiyah of a child is you're giving them proper manners, you're taking care of their diets, etc. So from physical point of view and a psychological and social point of view, they mature into a healthy, sound, decent human being. This is Tarbiyatul Awlad. Right? So, but now the thing I wanted, so there are two separate roots. But Rabba, that root, Tarbiyah, is included inside Rabb. They're not the same, but one is a subset of the other. In other words, when we say Rabb, when we call Allah Azza wa Jal Rabb, part of that meaning is Murabbi, the one who ensures growth. It's not the only meaning, but it's part of that meaning. So they're not the same. By the way, Imam Raghib al-Isfahani rahimahullah put them under the same category because there's one theory in classical Arabic where a root, if root letters are the last two letters, the Ayn and Lam letter are the same, or there's a naqis version. Like you have shaq, sheen, qaf, qaf, and there's another root, sheen, qaf, wow. Right? If that happens, then they can be considered similar or the same. There's one theory like that in Arabic. It's not a universally accepted theory, but Imam Raghib was inclined towards it, so he put Rabb and Rabba, or Rabba, Rabbi, Tarbiyah, in under the same category. Not to say that they're the same, but they are related. And the relationship is Rabb is the superset, and Rabba is the subset. Now let's get to the point itself. The owner, the authority, the one who takes care of. That Murabbi would mean the one who takes care of. Like your parents took care of you when you were small. So Allah says, Kama Rabbayani Sahira. Right? Now the thing is it possible you own something and you have authority of it, but you don't take care of it? Is that possible? It happens all the time. Look at your backyard. Look at the car you haven't done an oil change for 2 years. Right? Look at the computer who you haven't cleaned out the cache or whatever. And it's just piling on, and you get the blue screen of death every now and then. Lack of tarbiyah, lack of taking care. Now Allah is described, the word Rabb includes the one who owns it, has authority of it, and takes care of it. Wal Murabbi. Then Wal Murshid, sets it in the right direction, uses it properly, guides it too, that's part of Rabb. You know, uses it for proper usage, that's part of Rabb. And then Wal Mun'im, grants gifts. He's the one who gives gifts. In other words, the one, if Allah is Rabb to us, He doesn't owe us anything. Anything He gives us will be considered a gift. It's not something He's obligated to give us at all. It's considered a gift. That's part of the meaning of Rabb. Then Wal-Qayyim, and finally the word Al-Qayyim. Al-Qayyim implies the one, He's the one ensuring the existence of the subject. Right? So if we're subjects to Allah Azza wa Jal, then the only reason we exist is He allows us to exist. If you want to take a worldly parallel, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى, but just to help you understand the point, if you're taking care of a really delicate plant, and if you stop taking care of it for like one day, it would die, right? Or half an hour, it would just die. The only reason it's surviving is constant care. You are the reason for its continual existence. This is Qayyim. Allah Azza wa Jal calls Himself Al-Qayyim, and it's embedded in the meaning of Rabb. This is the word Rabb here. The word Rabb is really important for several reasons. One of them is, it's the first name Allah used to introduce Himself to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is also the first name Allah used for Himself, before He even used Allah, when He introduced Himself to Musa alayhi salam. When Allah introduced Himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, اقرأ بِسْمِ Rabbik, Rabb. The word Allah did not occur in the passage. Rabb did. Musa alayhi salam goes up on the mountain. Ya Musa, inni ana rabbuk fakhla'na alayk. Innaka bilwadi al-muqaddasi tuwa. Wa ana akhtartuka fastami' lima yuha innani ana Allah. Allah came later. Rabb came first. Rabb. So the word Rabb is the introduction Allah wants us to have. Even in the Fatiha, after Allah tells us about Himself as Allah, the first thing He wants us to know of all His names and attributes is what? Alhamdulillahi Rabb. And actually I told you, this sequence of the Quran is remarkable. Allah said, Allah mentioned Him, His lafzul jalala first, Allah. Then He said Rabbul Alameen. Look at the end of Quran. Suratul Ikhlas is Allah. Qul huwa Allah. Allah. And then two surahs about Rabb. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ رَبِّ النَّاسِ. Just like Fatiha, the first ayah is what? Allah first, Rabb second. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So you have Suratul Ikhlas about Allah, and the word Allah does not occur in Falaq or in Nas, but the word Rabb does. So there's the same progression that is made. And these things, you know, indicate something. Allah Azza wa Jalla, for example, commands in Quran in many places. One of them, for instance, اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ. Enslave yourself to your master. If you want to know, we study a lot of Quran, you know. You could study tafsir for years and years and years and years. And somebody, my teacher asked me actually, one time I was studying with him, and I'd been studying, not years, I was studying Quran with him for like 6 months, and he asked me, give me the summary of the Quran, one sentence. Actually, and I said, one sentence? He goes, okay, fine, two. So he wants a summary of the whole Quran in two sentences. And I'm thinking, I'm going, in my head, I'm doing a review of the stuff he talks about all the time. How am I going to summarize the entire Quran in two sentences? And I remembered what he said, and I used it, and he said, you're right. Alhamdulillah. Here's what it was. Number one, accept Allah as master and accept yourself as slave. A lot of people accept Allah as master, but they still don't accept themselves as slave. Just accept it. Internalize that he is master, you are slave. Accept that. Number one. And after you accept that, the second sentence, accept that this guidance is only beneficial to people who accept themselves as slaves. That's it. You say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. You accept yourself as slave. Then what are you ready for? إِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاط. Guidance. Slavery and guidance is the summary of the entire Qur'an. The Qur'an began with slavery, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. It begins with slavery, and at the end, again, he calls himself master, which alludes to us as what? If he's the master of the people are his slaves. Ends with slavery. So this is the heart of the matter. The heart of the matter is people refuse to accept Allah as slave. And by the way, this discussion will go a little further, inshallah ta'ala, today. But one of the side notes of it, a lot of people have no hard time accepting Allah as the creator. That's okay. That's not the hard part. Or accepting Allah as merciful, or as wise, or as powerful, or as one. All of that stuff's easy. Because you know, if you accept Allah as one, there may not be any implications on you. Allah is one, that's nice, I'm still gonna do what I'm gonna do. Allah is really merciful, great. I still have my life. But if you say Allah is master, then what does that make me? That makes me slave. And to put it in very simple terms, the difference between a free person and a slave person is very simple. It's not a complicated subject. The difference between a free person and a slave person is a free person does whatever he or she wants. What does a slave do? A slave cannot do what he or she wants. If a slave did what he or she wanted, then they would be considered free. The only thing that makes them a slave is they do what the master wants. If you accept that, if you accept that your will comes under the will of Allah, your will has to be submitted like a slave before the will of the master. Then you've understood what this deen, what this book is, what this message is. That's the summary of this message. It sounds very simple. I mean, it takes 5 minutes to explain, but internalizing that is a lifelong struggle. A lifelong struggle. SubhanAllah. So now we're going to look at how Allah Azza wa Jalla in this surah.